Hi, I'm Nathan Zampronio, one of your Hawkesbury City Councillors, and it's time that we talked about Hawkesbury Council's poor record of customer service. One of the things that I have heard more often than any other thing during this term of council is how consistently council disappoints you in terms of simple customer service requests and things like development application turnaround. Too many anecdotal stories to talk about. People who go in at the commencement of their DA process and find that the process takes 6 months or longer. People who go in and find that council are asking for a certain raft of things, and then after months, council comes back and says that they're actually asking for other things that weren't asked for in the first place. It's not good enough, and you deserve better. Now we have hard data to back up what we already knew. Council commissioned a survey to see how we were tracking for customer service. 4 out of 10 people expressed complete dissatisfaction with council's customer service, and 51% felt that we were dropping the ball badly on the essential things like road maintenance. Council's average DA turnaround time is on the order of 170 days. That's 6 months, and is up from 147 days only a year ago. Now, you need to compare that to our peers and neighbours in other councils. Blue Mountain City Council has an average DA turnaround time of only 85 days. And our neighbours in Camden and Wallandilly Council, it's 66 days. And we're at 170. We are doing twice as poorly. In fact, we have 7 DAs in our system right now that have been there for more than 700 days, or more than 2 years. No wonder you're all angry and disappointed. The best examples I can give of this are landowners at Cornwallis and Lower Portland who needed to do urgent erosion protection works on their riverbanks because they fringed the river and part of their bank was washed away in the floods back in March. They've now been told by our council that they will have to apply for expensive and complicated DAs and get multiple reports that will cost them tens of thousands of dollars before they can do simple erosion protection works. Whereas our neighbours on the other side of the river in Hillshire Council have given them permission to go and do those erosion protection works without any further delay. And these landowners have contacted me wondering why we can't do the same, and I tend to agree. Or let's take the story of Gordon, who lives down at Lower Portland and who lived in a tiny slab hut that had some historic character while he built a larger house elsewhere on the property. Let's hear what happened when he had to interact with council. Meet Gordon Eckle. He lives out here with his wife Belle and 2 small kids at Lower Portland on the shores of the beautiful Colo River. 27 and a half acres at the end of a dirt road. What he did exemplifies the kind of thing that I've been talking about for years. This historic slab cottage was on the property when he bought it, and he and his family scraped by with inadequate bathroom, no cooking facilities, just so that they could get a house built further up on their property. Now that that house has been built, council are obliging him to knock this down, but he doesn't want to use it as a secondary habitation. He wants to use it as a home office for his wife. What does your wife do?
So she's a specialty trauma and, actually torture counsellor working with New South Wales Health, with a lot of refugees who've come from pretty terrible regimes, and she needs somewhere quiet to be able to work, whether it's either over Zoom or in person.
So working from home, the kids are being exposed to talk about distressing things that you'd rather not have them hear. Being able to come down here and work in a home office seems like the logical solution. Now, this cottage is how many square metres?
24 square metres.
24 square metres. You could build a granny flat that's up to 60 square metres in the backyard of a block in Bly Park that's under 800 square metres in total. He's on 27 and a half acres here, where the nearest neighbours are miles away, where nobody really minds, but he's going to be obliged to knock this down. And that's why I've been really keen to ensure that when we renovate our planning code, our LEP, that it allows for this kind of structure, which offends nobody, to stay here. Council are going to ask him to knock this heritage structure down for no good reason. Gordon, I want you to tell me about the problems that you've had with council, with council's customer service culture and the planning department particularly and the moving goalposts. Okay. Tell me about that.
Well, I think calling it a customer service culture is, most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. I, you know, even just with our, this is now the third time we've tried with council, because they've said, if you do this and put another DA in, then, you know, we'll approve it. And then, oh, you need another six reports for that. So there goes another, you've got this, $2,500 for every report that you need. So we went through that. You know, we went through, and then, oh, we'll deny it on this basis, and then you'll have to put an appeal in, and then, well, we need another couple of reports to round that out.
So it's the moving goalposts. It's going in and saying, what do you need from us, providing that, and then down the track, them asking for a whole heap of other things that they didn't ask for.
Yeah, oh, look, we had the former head of planning say, look, you know, you can keep it if you put it in for tourist and visitor accommodation, and we're like, oh, okay, we'll do that. But they wouldn't give us actually a DA or a construction certificate until we'd actually demolished the roof over our heads. So that cost us $25,000 to go to the Land and Environment Court just so that we'd have somewhere to live, because, you know, council's opinion was that's not our problem as to where you live.
And even though they knew that you were living here and you were building the house, they were going to oblige you to demolish this before they'd even let you start building.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
The main house, and your question was, well, where am I going to live?
Not my problem.
That was what you heard from council.
Not our problem.
That is not acceptable.
But the, you know, with this recent, you know, application, you know, our planner has been working with council for years and years and years, and he's never experienced anything like this with this particular project that he was asked as a favour from some other consultants to council to help us with. He hasn't had a single phone call back. He's put, I don't know how many phone calls in. There's been zero communication, zero responses on email. Absolutely stonewalled, zero negotiation entered into, absolutely no assistance to find any sort of path forward whatsoever. It's not in the public interest to be able to keep this little structure. And, the thing is,
you know, you came along at a point where I'd been thinking about this for years, and it is the most common complaint that I've had as a councillor over this five-year period. People that want to do simple things, like build a shed, and they go to their pre-approval meeting and they say, what do you need? And the council says, we want A, B and C. And then 6 months later, they're asking for a whole heap of other stuff that's more expensive that they didn't anticipate. And it was, well, why didn't you ask us for this in the first point? It's moving goalposts. Now, Gordon, tell me about what message you have for voters at the upcoming local government elections.
Think about who you're going to vote for, because, you know, it actually has an impact. This kind of bureaucratic madness, it's bureaucracy gone mad. And, you know, an internal culture which is to basically deny, and, oh, hang on, let's ask them for another five reports. This has real world, this stuff really, you know, it has real world impact, on people, you know, and their families and their livelihoods. I mean, you know, old bloke across the road a bunch of years ago who had been fighting council for years to be able to get his house built, and in the end he hung himself in the shed that he and his missus were living in, and she couldn't handle that anymore, so they moved out. And I doubt that's a story in isolation. There's, you know, look, we're at the point that, okay, we're going to demolish this, because we need our occupation certificate for our insurance, our bushfire insurance. And after the fires of, you know, 2019, 2020, I spent 3 months on the fire trucks with that, and it wasn't much fun. You know, good in fire insurance out here. If you're going to live in the bush, you kind of expect that, you know, it's the Australian bush, there are bushfires. But if you don't have your occupation certificate, then, you know, it gets very, very, very expensive. And it all just adds up. And after wasting tens of thousands of dollars trying to retain this structure, we're at the point we've just given up. You know, the Hawkesbury planning team win again, open some champagne. It's just, you know, it's absolute bureaucracy gone mad that, you know, a 24 square metre slab hut, it's just perfect. I'm on the phone until all hours of the night with my clients. I do a lot of stuff that's offshore and international, and it's all on computer and Zoom calls, which is great, but I can't be having those phone calls, you know, in my house, because it's 120 square metres, our main house. It's 120 square metres. We didn't put an extra home office in there because we were told that we should be able to keep this, and this is kind of perfect, and it's quiet, and it's away from the house. Mm. It just kind of made sense. But every time we've tried, oh, here's another bunch of reports that you got to do. Here's another bunch of reports to do. And it just adds up. So we're at the point we've just given up.
Mm.
We'll demolish it, and you know, it's in the community interest. I mean, The entire street and anyone who's been here is just absolutely horrified by it. And it's just madness.
It's a lack of common sense. And the thing I'll say in closing is this isn't about any one applicant and his story and his desire to get, you know, something through council. And this is the kind of decision where councillors no longer have any decision-making power. I have no decision-making power about this. Things are either delegated to staff or they're devolved out to planning panels. But it's the example that this provides of an endemic problem with council and its culture that mean that it's impossible to get anything through, even common sense things, even things that benefit families, not developers, not business magnates, not vested interests, but people who just want to get along with their lives and do reasonable things but can't because council is getting in their way. It is time for reform of Hawkesbury Council.
And I'm into that.
I'm hopeful that this kind of story makes you think carefully about how you're going to vote in December. Thanks.
Do so.
What these stories tell us is that council needs reform and that you need to vote for councillors who are going to push the process of making our council as responsive as you deserve it to be. I'm seeking your support. I and my team, we are Group A in the upcoming Hawkesbury Council elections, and we would very much appreciate your support. Thanks for watching.